الله الرحمن الرحيم. I praise Allah, the Almighty alone, and I send the best peace and blessings upon His most beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Brothers and sisters, welcome to another live episode in the series of Guardians of the Pious. Today, by the grace of Allah, is an episode number 99 in the series. Today, inshallah, also will begin the 19th chapter, and that is the first episode in this chapter. The chapter is known as Whoever sets a good deed or a bad deed as a precedent. Insha'Allah, we will begin by studying the ayat which Al-Imam al-Nawawi, may Allah have mercy on him, listed in the beginning of the chapter, and there are only two. The ayah of Surah Al-Furqan, one of the most lovely ayat and one of the greatest invocations. If you're following our programs, I openly recommend that we should invoke Allah, the Almighty, via this invocation. Towards the end of Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listed the traits of His servants whom He loves. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. And towards the end, a very important trait of the servants, of the most beneficent, is that they frequently invoke Allah, pray to Allah, make the following supplication. Allah the Almighty said, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Ayah number 74 of Surah Al-Furqan. And the other ayah is ayah number 73 of Surah Al-Anbiya. But let's live for a few moments with the beautiful ayah, one of the greatest invocations in the Quran and in general, which is listed in ayah number 74 of Surah Al-Furqan. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. It is very important to study the traits of Ibad al-Rahman from the beginning. But because we don't have that much time to discuss them in this episode, I will just focus on the ayah which is pertaining this chapter. What kind of dua is this? What is the meaning of this dua? And those who say, our Lord, grant us from our spouses and offspring comfort to our eyes, and make us an example, a role model, leaders for the righteous ones. Why did I say appoint for us or grant for us from amongst our spouses, not only wives? Because Ibadur Rahman are not only of the men, but also of women. So husbands and wives. من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن. Whosoever does a good deed, whether a male or a female, while being a believer, فلنحيينه حياة طيبة وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Which means, there is no difference between a male and a female when it comes to doing good righteous deeds. And this dua is fit for both. So the believing men and the believing women, عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ, invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala via this dua. And the word azwaj, brothers and sisters, is plural of zawj. And many people, even amongst the Arab, are under the impression that the word zawj is only limited to the masculine, limited to the husband. No. Azwaj is a word that describes the spouse, whether it's he or she, the husband, or the wife. And the Quran has many references in this regard. In Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 25, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَهُمْ فِيهَا أَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَّرَةٌ وَهُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. For the believing men who will enter paradise, they would have purified wives, azwaj. So he used a term which many people may think it's only for masculine to describe feminine, or even both, masculine or feminine, plural of zawj. If you travel with me to Surah An-Nisa, you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. O people, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul, Adam alayhi salam, وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. زَوْجَهَا, the pronoun of her refers to the soul of Adam alayhi salam, peace be upon him. So the word زَوْج, he refers to whom? Refers to the second spouse who created, that is Eve or Hawa, peace be upon her. وَبَثَ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. In Surah Al-Ahzab, there are two ayat which talk about the same. Azwaj refers to the wives in these two ayat. For instance, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فِي أَزْوَاجِ أَدْعِيَائِهِمْ, the wives of their adopted children. So we're talking about azwaj as wives, plural of zawj. But when you say zawjah, zawjah, then it only refers to the wife. But the word zawj means either one of the spouses, either one of the couple. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us to invoke him, which he would reward us a great deal for using this invocation as a mean of dua. رَبَّنَا, our Lord, هَبْ لَنَا, grant us, give us, gift us, مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّتِنَا, of our spouses. So if the husband is making the dua, he's praying for his wife. If the wife is making the dua, she is praying then for her husband. وَذُرِّيَّتِنَا, and our offspring, it refers to the children, and their children, and their descendants. قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنْ, أَعْيُن, plural of عَيْن, which means an eye. قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ, what is the meaning of قُرَّةُ الْعَيْن? We hear this term awfully. In fact, the word قُرَّة means one of two meanings in Arabic. One which is settlement, comfort, الثبات, اللزوم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قرن في بيوتكن, settle at your homes, settle at your homes. And the other meaning is the coolness and the comfort. So القرة refers to either the settlement and being stable, being satisfied, or the coolness. When you say, may Allah make your spouse and your children coolness for your eyes, that applies to any other thing that you possess, wealth, job, knowledge, whatever. قُرَّةَ عَيْن, comfort for your eyes, coolness for your eyes. Even in medicine, when the eye is experiencing excessive heat, it's a sign of being sick versus when the eye is cool. And the eye is an organ which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved in a very special cavity, in a very special protection in the skull, because it's a very special organ through which we can see. So when you invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ, your spouse, your children is like your eye. You're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make them the coolness of your eye, to make you settle, to make you become very happy and comfortable with your spouse and your children. And how would this be achieved? النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the sound hadith, ما استفاد المؤمن بعد تقوى الله خيرا له من زوجة صالحة. The biggest gain that a believer can obtain in this life after being an obedient servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be blessed with a righteous wife. What are the traits of the righteous wife? النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إن أمرها أطاعت, إن نظر إليها سرت, إن أقسم عليها أبرت, إن غاب عنه حفظته في نفسها وفي ماله. A wife whom when you see her, you'll be pleased. You're happy to see her. Once you come home, he can't wait to come home because she pleases you. She is very beautiful and you're very happy with whom she is. And the opposite is true as well. I mean, the man should also look nice for his spouse, for his wife. Not only one way, that she has to appear pretty before him and he comes covered with wax and smelly. No, Abdullah ibn Abbas said, I like to adorn myself for my wife the same way I like her to adorn herself for me. Whenever he orders her to do something within her capacity and it is halal, she said, sure. And also, whenever he is absent, she guards her chastity and she protects his wealth. She's a very smart woman. Now, that is the biggest and the greatest gain. Besides that, having a continuation of your journey, a continuation and an extension of yourself. If you are a believer, you like to have children who would pray for you, who would do good deeds so that you will get a similar thawab of theirs. As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a waladin salihin yad'u lah. Guess what? Even bad parents or any of them happens to be bad, he does not wish for his child to be the same. An Egyptian actor who is very known of being rebellious, is no secret, said, I would like my daughter to be an actress. He was asked, why not? You're very proud of your job and you believe that what you're offering to the people is a message. He said, no, forget about all of that. This is all filth. I wouldn't like anyone to kiss my daughter and she sleeps with him in bed pretending that they are acting. It's a filthy environment. This is what he said. A woman who doesn't wear hijab calls me and she said, Sheikh, can you talk to my daughters? Try to convince them to wear hijab. They're young, they're pretty, they're grown up at measurable age. I said, what about you yourself? She said, I'm afraid that they will go to hell. What about you yourself? So even if the person is indulged into disobedience, he will be very keen, she will be very keen to save and spare their children. Even if they're righteous and the children are wicked, they're still praying for them. Look what Nuh alayhi salam did with his son. Rabbi innabni min ahli wa inna wa'daka al-haq. So here, brothers and sisters, this is a very beautiful dua and may Allah accept. Let's say it all together. Rabbana hab lana min azwajina wa dhurriyatina qurrata a'yunin waj'alna lil muttaqina imama. A question is raised, which is, wait a minute. Why exactly do we discuss this ayah and the chapter is concerning whoever sets a good or a bad precedent, a bad deed as a precedent? Yeah, because here we're going to talk about that you will be earning the thawab of each person who will copy you and imitate you. And the ayah ends up and the dua is sealed up with the following beautiful invocation. وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Here, brothers and sisters, we're not just simply asking Allah to be righteous. No. Rather to be the leaders, the emirs, the role model for the righteous ones. Why? In order to earn our own thawab and also to earn a similar thawab and reward for everyone who would follow us and imitate us. Does this apply to my son, to my daughter, whom I taught and raised up properly, and I taught them the deen, and I made them righteous kids? Yes. Not only that, and because they were righteous, they made the right choice with regards to their spouses, and they also raised their children the same way, you will still get a similar reward, endless reward, as long as this good deed is continuous because of you. وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Remember when we said, do not do Umrah and say, oh Allah, give the thawab of my Umrah to the Prophet. Or perform Hajj instead of the Prophet. Or pray Qabr Rak'ahs and say, I give the thawab, the reward to the Prophet. Because the reward, a similar reward of every good that we do, automatically is going to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because he is the main cause behind the guidance that we have today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tur in ayah number 21, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاتَّبَعَتْهُمْ ذُرِّيَّتُهُمْ بِإِيمَانٍ أَلْحَقَنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ. It is not that we just love to enter paradise and that's it. No, we love for our family members, our spouses, our children and grandchildren also to join us. It is true that كل امرئ بما كسب رهين. Every person will be held accountable for their earning, the good for good and the bad for bad. No bearer of a sin will bear the sin of another. But we're making dua and we're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our spouses and our offspring also righteous and make us leaders to the righteous so that we can all join each other. Alhaqana bihim dhurriyatahum wa ma alatnahum min amalihim min shay. So that we can all enter paradise by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now with the second ayah we have, which is a part of ayah number 73 of Surah Al-Anbiya. This ayah is preceded by several ayat which were talking about Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him from fire which were kindled to burn him and spared him from the arrogant disbelievers, his own people, including his father. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with the children, Ismail, Ishaq, then Yaqub nafilatan. He gave him even the glad tiding that he would have a grandson, his name is Yaqub as well. وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ نَافِلَةً وَكُلًّا جَعَلْنَا صَالِحِينَ. And we made them all righteous. Ibrahim alayhi salam and his offspring and Lut alayhi salam was also mentioned in ayah number 71. Okay. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in ayah number 73, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يهدون بأمرنا وأوحينا إليهم فعل الخيرات وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة وكانوا لنا عابدين. And we made them leaders guiding by our command. Leaders, and that is the greatest blessing. They were not just righteous, but they were also righteous, and they were leaders and like guides for the righteous after them, so that they get a similar thawab, a reward of everyone who would follow them. This quality that they did not earn simply because they were prophets or descendants of Ibrahim alayhi salam. If you want to know for what did they get this, go back to Surah Al-Sajda in ayah number 24, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ, we made from them, not all of them, أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. As a result of their patience. وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. When Allah ordered Ismail a.s. to enjoin his family to the prayer, he said, اصطبر عليها, be patient. Why do you guys think that it's a piece of cake? Son, you gotta pray. My daughter, you have to do this. Okay, daddy, I will do it. No. Be very patient. It takes forever in order to bring a generation which will be righteous. Be steadfast. Be steadfast until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and never give up. Never say, I tried every possible mean. Not a chance. You have the dua. You have all the means, talking to people, to guide them, give them examples. But the catch in all of those ayat, how the leaders in righteousness and in guidance are superior to others. They did not demand, nor were they given a leadership in the dunya, like kings, rulers, princes. No, the leadership which is praiseworthy in knowledge, in religious commitment. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ فَعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ وَإِقَامَ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيتَاءَ الزَّكَاةِ وَكَانُوا لَنَا عَابِدِينَ. This is ayah number 73 of Surah Al-Anbiya, talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam and his offspring. And in ayah number 24 of Surah Al-Sajda, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا, they guide people by our command. لَمَّا صَبَرُوا, as a result of their patience. وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ, and they were certain in our ayat. يعني they were strong and powerful believers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst them. Now, with the beautiful hadith in the chapter number 19. I would like to remind you with the chapter. Whoever sets a good or a bad precedent. The hadith is hadith number 171. It's kind of long hadith, but as we agreed before, we would love to learn the Arabic text as well. An Abi Amr, Jarir ibn Abdullah radiyallahu anhu, qal, kunna fi sadr al-nahar. عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فجاءه قوم عراة مجتاب النمار أو العباء متقلد السيوف عامتهم من مضر بل كلهم من مضر فتمعر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لما رأى بهم من الفاقة فدخل ثم خرج فأمر بلالا فأذن وأقام فصلى ثم خطب فقال يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة إلى آخر الآية إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا والآية الأخرى التي في آخر الحشر يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد تصدق رجل من ديناره من درهمه من ثوبه من صاع بره من صاع تمره حتى قال ولو بشق تمرة فجاء رجل من الأنصار بصرة كادت كفه تعجز عنها بل قد عجز ثم تتابع الناس حتى رأيت كومين من طعام وثياب حتى رأيت وجه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتهلل كأنه مذهبة فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من سن في الإسلام سنة حسنة فله أجرها وأجر من عمل بها بعده من غير أن ينقص من أجورهم شيء ومن سن في الإسلام سنة سيئة كان عليه وزرها ووزر من عمل بها من بعده من غير أن ينقص من أوزارهم شيء رواه مسلم. And the meaning of this hadith, this companion Jarir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that once we were sitting with the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the early hours of the morning. Some people came there who were partly naked, wearing woolen clothes which were made into stripes or cloths, with their swords hung around their necks. Most of them, rather all of them, belong to the tribe of Mudar. The face of the Prophet, peace be upon him, changed when he saw them in dire need. Then he went into his house and he came out. Then he ordered Bilal, may Allah be pleased with him, to call Adhan. So he did call Adhan and then he called the Iqama and the Prophet, peace be upon him, led the prayer. Then the Prophet on it, without diminishing the burden from either one of them. The hadith is collected by Imam Muslim, and we just have to take a short break before we get back to you to discuss and learn this beautiful hadith together. So please stay tuned. رسول الله حبيب الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. Our phone numbers beginning with area code are 002-0100-246-4583 and the other number is area code 002-0112-500-8679. The email address is gardens@huda.tv. What do we have here? This long hadith which talks about some very extremely poor people from the tribe of Mudar who showed up in the masjid before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mujtabi an-nimar. What is the meaning of mujtabi an-nimar? Let's look at this vocabulary so that we can comprehend the hadith properly. The word sadr an-nahar means the early part of the morning. So early morning. An-nimar, plural of namira, which is tribe woolen clothes. It's not actually clothes, like a sheet with stripes on it. And I will show you how did they wear that sheet. The word tama'ara means change. The face of the Prophet ﷺ changed. The color of his face changed as a sign of disapproval, as a sign of anger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. While on the other hand, Mudhaba, his face afterward turn into mudhaba, which is like glittering gold or like very bright moon, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The word mutaqallidi suyuf, with their swords hung around or from their necks. The word alfaqa means the dire need. Here what we have. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting in the masjid. Thereupon, some people walked in and they appeared in dire need, desperately in need. How did they look like in need? Because they were mujtabi nimar. And namira is like a sheet of wool. Let's take this sheet as an example. And it is not actually closed. Rather, they made a hole in the middle like that. So that they can wear it around their neck if I bring a bottle. And that's it. This is how they wear. Like if you've seen the Red Indians, but the Red Indians used to wear it on top of their clothes or under clothes. But these guys from Mudar, this is all what they had on. Mujtabi and Nimar. Imagine in this extreme hot weather, these guys are wearing wool because this is all what they could found. And meanwhile, they had nothing beneath it. And also, the narrator says, Jarir, may Allah be pleased with him, said that they had their swords hung from their necks. They came to the Prophet ﷺ offering themselves to join the army, but they have nothing except this namira on each one of them, which they cut from the middle and they put it on just to cover their awra. And they were extremely hungry. Tama'ara wajhu an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The companion said the Prophet ﷺ never got mad for himself. Even if somebody upset him, insulted him, or hurt his feeling, he would not even bother. Only whenever any of the rights of Allah would be violated, then the Prophet ﷺ, his face will get extremely red. He will be very angry. إِذَنْ تُهِكَتْ حُرُمَاتُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. So Nabi ﷺ's face tama'ar, turned exceedingly red, which showed that he was very angry and upset. Then he entered into his house. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam normally would begin by himself. If he would order any his companions or his followers to do anything, he would begin by himself. But repeatedly, he wanted to give anything, and his wife said that we have nothing but water. And it did not only happen all of a sudden today. No, it's been days since we have nothing at home but water. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stepped out, and he asked Bilal to call Adhan. And we studied before, كَانَ إِذَا حَزَبَهُ أَمْرٌ فَزَعَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. Anything would worry the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would resort to the prayer. Because whom would he complain to better than Allah, greater than Allah, more capable to resolve this issue than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Bilal Azim, he called the Adhan for dhuhr. Then the Iqama, then they prayed. Then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned around. And he delivered the speech. He began the speech by reciting the ayah, which we normally recite in Khutbat al-Hajah. In the beginning of our speeches, the ayah in the beginning of Surah Nisa, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ وَالَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. And we studied several times. He reminded his companions with the importance of keeping your duty to Allah, fearing Allah, remembering your origin, and also remembering your fate. Then he shifted to another ayah of Surah Al-Hashr in order to remind with the fate. Ayah number 18 of Surah Al-Hashr, chapter number 59, he said, اتقوا ربكم, اتقوا الله, fear Allah, ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد. Fear your Lord and let everyone examine what have you prepared for tomorrow. What did you prepare for tomorrow? What did you send forth as an investment, as an asset of good deeds that will benefit you? The word, the moral here, or lagad, refers to the day of judgment. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Well, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reminded his companions with the importance of keeping their duty to Allah, and we have a situation here, each person started bringing a dirham, a dinar. Somebody would bring a sa', a bowl, or a measure full of dates, full of But these guys were plenty and they were exceedingly poor. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam furthermore encouraged them. He said, donate, even if it is just a half date, anything that you can afford. And you see the importance of paying attention to the need of any members of the Ummah, even if they do not belong to your tribe, even if they do not belong to your family. But each and every Muslim, no matter where he or she is at, have rights upon the whole Ummah. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tama'ara wajhu, his face turned red and he was very angry because he saw some Muslims who were in need while others were full. Imagine if the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is alive today and he visits those rulers, kings, princes and sheikhs, the leaders of the Muslim Ummah, enjoying eating and drinking, lying down on silk and drinking alcohol and wine, enjoying all the haram, while Muslims in Gaza being killed and massacred, babies, infants, women, children, every day and every night. And they do not lift a finger. Rather, Allah knows better. They're maybe even supporting the aggression against them under the table or by being silent. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam foreseen some Muslims who were in need, tama'ara wajhu. And he did not settle until he gathered the Ummah and ordered everyone to give his head whatever he can afford. If you have a date, one single date fruit, split it. Allah will accept it from you. Thereupon, one of the companions of Al-Ansar, very soft-hearted, may Allah be pleased with them. Al-Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam loved Al-Ansar, the rulers of Al-Madinah, so much. He went home and he brought a container, a bag, duffel bag, full of money that he was struggling to carry. Then he placed it before the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. People saw that this man brought so much wealth, so they were encouraged to give. So they started giving more and more until Jarir, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that I ended up seeing two piles, two mountains, one of food and one of clothes, which was pretty much sufficient to cover the needs of those people from Mudr. Look at the difference. In the first place, in the first stage, when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saw the people of Mudr desperately in need and dire need, his face tama'ara wajhu and turned red. And now Jarir, may Allah be pleased with him, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the Prophet's face turned so bright, ka'annahu mudhabah, like a shining moon or sun, like glittering gold, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was very happy. Now we fulfill the requirements of being a united ummah. مثل المؤمنين في توادهم وتراحمهم وتعاطفهم كمثل الجسد الواحد إذا اشتكى منه عضو تداعى له سائر الجسد بالحمى والسهر. The similitude of this ummah is like one single body. If any part of the body, if any organ, if any little finger aches or is having pain, the whole body is aching. The whole body is experiencing fever because of the pain here or there. من الحمى والسهر. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was very happy to see that. And then he remarked saying, whoever introduces a good practice in Islam, alhamdulillah that we have the reason of the hadith, because some people say in order to support their innovations, say, well, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, man sanna fil islami sunnatan hasana. Here is the meaning of the sunnah. He took the initiative. He took the precedence. He encouraged people to follow him, either by reviving sunnah or by excelling in a good deed to encourage others to do it, not by inventing a new practice in the religion. Then he shall receive its reward, and similarly, everyone who will do like him, he will get a similar reward of him without diminishing the reward of either the one who started it or the followers. In a fundraise, somebody tempted others, and his intention was to do so. That's why he disclosed and he showed his check. And he said, I'm giving 50 grand. His intention was to encourage others. And they were encouraged. So he gets similar word of every donor after him. Because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, إِن تُبْدُوا الصَّدَقَاتِ فَنِعِمَّهِ. Whenever you show your charity for this reason, that is excellent. You and your intention. So this is very important. On the other hand, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said, and whoever introduces a bad practice in the deen shall bear its sin, and on his shoulder will be the sin of everyone who would follow him afterward. Now, brothers and sisters, with the last hadith in this chapter, it's a very important hadith as well. Hadith number 172, narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. May Allah be pleased with him. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu قال أن نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ليس من نفس تقتل ظلما إلا كان على ابن آدم الأول كفل من دمها لأنه كان أول من سن القتل لأنه كان أول من سن القتل متفق عليه. The word if means share. And the hadith means that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no soul is killed unlawfully, but there is a share of the sin on the first son of Adam. Who was he? Qabil. Because he was the first one to set the precedent of killing. And that is explained in details, brothers and sisters, in Surah Al-Ma'idah. لَإِنْ بَسَطَّ إِلَيَّ يَدَكَ لِتَقْتُلَنِي مَا أَنَا بِبَاسِطٍ يَدِي إِلَيْكَ لِأَقْتُلَكَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. When Qabil intended to kill his brother and he disclosed his evil intention, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in fact, Habil was more powerful than Qabil and he was more capable to kill him. But he said, I'm not going to do that. Even if you try to kill me, I'm not going to kill you because I fear Allah, the Lord of everything that exists. فطوعت له نفسه قتل أخيه فقتله. But his evil soul made it seem fair to him to kill his brother, and he killed him. فأصبح من الخاسرين, has become of the losers. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that he sent a crow to show him how to bury his brother after he carried him for 2 days. He doesn't know what to do with the corpse. He regretted. He did not regret killing his brother, rather he regretted that he was so dumb and ignorant, he could not even act like a crow. Allah showed him via the crow. The crow dug the ground in order to bury a dead crow. So he imitated him. فَأَصْبَحَ مِنَ النَّادِمِينَ, he regretted. Abdullah ibn Abbas says, regretted here does not mean he regretted, he repented. No, he regretted that he was so fool, he could not even be like a crow. He didn't know what to do with the corpse of his brother. But he did not regret from the sin. Had he regretted and repented, the sin would have been forgiven, and he would not bear the sin of every murderer who commits a murder. We are in August. This is almost 69 years since 1945. When the United States of America dropped the first atomic bomb on Hiroshima in Japan, killing at least 300,000 human beings or even more. And they tried to justify that by saying that it would save lives. I don't know how could killing 300,000-400,000 human beings would be to save lives and to spread peace. But the person who were behind this atomic nuclear bomb, every time people are getting killed using this tool, imagine it's not one or two or three, but hundreds of thousands of people. He gets the sin of killing every innocent people, every innocent human being. The drone killing innocent civilians here and there without the least even feeling sorry or apology, like killing mosquitoes and rats. The time will come and you will pay for that. But the catch, according to the hadith and the references which we're discussing, is that whoever kills a single human being is like one who killed all human beings. This is what Allah said in conclusion after the story of Qabil and Habil, who killed his brother. He said, من أجل ذلك كتبنا على بني إسرائيل أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا. وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Allah has ordained, whoever kills a single innocent soul without justification, he will be treated as if he has killed all mankind. And if he saved a single human being, he will be rewarded as if he saved all humanity at large. Before we end, I'd like to indulge right away in the next chapter, chapter number 20, with regards to calling to right guidance and forbidding evil. Al-amru bil-ma'roof wal-nahyu 'anil munkar. And there are some beautiful ayat, Surah Al-Qasas, wad'u ila rabbika wa la takunanna min al-mushrikeen. Invite people to your Lord and never be of those who associate others to Allah. Also, the ayah Surah Al-Ma'idah, we studied it before. وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Cooperate in righteousness and piety and do not cooperate in sin and aggression. And the ayah which made this ummah superior to others because of this quality. وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Ayah number 104 of Surah Al-Imran, the third chapter of the Quran. Let there be a rising from you, a nation inviting to all that is good and forbid all that is evil. And such are the truly successful ones. May Allah the Almighty make us from amongst them. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price.